Hi everyone, my name is Olivier Jimenez. I'm a researcher at the National Center for Scientific Research in France, and I'm going to talk about my first steps in deep learning with its application to the identification of animal species on pictures taken with camera traps. Okay, so I'm working a lot on predator-prey interactions these days. These are interactions between species that structure communities of large mammals. This is joint work with Anna Chen, Maëlys Kervenec, both first-year master students, Vincent Miel, deep learning MC, and colleagues from the French Office for Biodiversity and from hunting associations. The main question we are interested in is to understand how predators, prey, and their environment interact. So to address these issues, our colleagues collect data in the natural habitat of the species we're studying and using camera traps set up in strategic places. So we don't use this kind of material. It will disappear in no time. Instead, these camera traps are used. These are installed on both sides of the path used by animals, like this lynx female with her kittens. These methods are non-invasive, meaning that we don't have to physically capture individuals. The big issue is that we get tons of pictures, which we need to annotate with species ID. And this is where deep learning is useful. The idea is first to use annotated pictures to train models to identify species. And second, we may use these models to identify species on any non-annotated pictures. And to make my first steps in deep learning, I use the resources available on this website called Imagine Ecology, a website that we built in our French National Center for Statistical Ecology. Give it a try. It's really awesome. It's full of relevant and useful resources. And there is an introduction to deep learning, codes, papers, and data to train your own models. And there's also a series of tutorials that are very didactic. And kudos to Vincent and Gaspar for amazing work. So I used the tutorial called Detection of Animals on Camera Traps on Camera Trap Images. I used RetinaNet that implements a two-step strategy with detection and classification. And you may find my peregrinations on GitHub. So before going to the results, disclaimer, I'm a beginner and these results are only preliminary. My colleagues should not be made responsible for my errors, of course. So what are our results? First, I used transfer learning on a study site we had in the Jura County, where we had a bunch of annotated pictures. The results look pretty good, actually. We succeed in detecting and identifying lynx individuals and its prey and their prey, like chamois and rodir, with a high level of certainty. It's also the case for other species that appear on the pictures, so everything is okay. Then I used my model to automatically annotate a bunch of pictures that were taken at another site in the Ain County. The cool thing is that these pictures were also annotated so that we could go through a step of testing the model. So we get some results that can be arranged as follows. In columns, you have the species here, true positives, false positives, and false negatives. So we're doing pretty well for the lynx, but we kind of wonderfully fail at identifying its prey with an excess of false positives for the chamois and an excess of false negatives for rodeo. So it took me some time to get over the frustration, and then I asked myself why the results were so bad. And we came up with several reasons for why. We know, for example, that generalizing from one site to another site is tricky with deep learning. Traps might be different, as well as the environmental conditions, the exposition, etc. Another reason might be that our training dataset was simply too small. And so the next thing I'm going to do is to pull both datasets together from the two counties and train again my model. Okay, so as a way to end my this short talk, let me go through a few lessons I learned from along the way from my first steps. First, terminology is tricky. It's an obstacle. It can be an obstacle. On the Imagine Ecology website, you will find a glossary that might help. Also, I recommend exploring the material shared by Jennifer Hotting and the video of her talk at the last International Statistical Ecology Conference. The viewpoint of a statistician is useful to make the parallel with the familiar vocabulary. Also, along the way, I asked myself a lot of questions. First, about reproducibility. Training a model is like cooking with its share of improvisation. And I wonder what we can do to make this cooking reproducible. Second, there are legal and ethical consideration that should be raised when we analyze pictures on which our species puts itself on stage. And I don't have the answers to these considerations, but that's something we should think of. Third, there is the question of the carbon footprint of deep learning, as we often have to use GPUs for long periods. And here the advice that I was given is rather than buying GPUs for myself, is to use mutualized resources in universities or research centers. Fourth, my advice is to check out what the experts are doing, of course. For example, there is a challenge organized by Sarah Beery in which the best teams share their recipes. Talking about Sarah, I warmly recommend to follow her on Twitter as well as Mikey Tabak. Both are yodas of deep learning for ecology. Last, it's pretty clear that the deep learning community speaks Python. Therefore, learning the language Python cannot hurt. And if, like me, you are a heavy R user, these two books might be of help. There is Python for R programmers here. And there is also this book, Learn R and Python in Parallel. Both books are very, very, very useful if you want to learn Python coming from the R language. And thank you for listening.